This is my Minecraft clone, and I want to make it more optimized than Minecraft is. You see, I started working at this project for a long time, and I want it to be the best one on YouTube. But over time, I started getting some good competitors, like Finding Fortunes game. Bro, look at this render distance. I really need to also implement LODs at some point if I want to compete with that. To get there, however, I need to also optimize the server, and I found a trick to easily split it into as many threads as needed. And you will quickly see that writing a server is very similar to writing an OS. So today, we'll also dive into how does an optimized server for a Minecraft-like game looks like. And I'll also be adding some missing features to it. So let's start with something that I really wanted to add for a long time, server commands. For that, we actually need a chat to write the command into. So I'm thinking I'll do the same way Minecraft does it. Yeah, here we go. So now you can type stuff here and it will send a message to the server. And here the server will just send back the messages to the clients. Okay, now if that message starts with a slash, that means it is a command. So we execute the command instead and we send back the result as a message. Now to parse the command, it's actually pretty easy. First we split the command into individual tokens. I did this like 2 times already for this project. So I'll just cut ChatGPT for help. Okay, and now that all the commands are split into tokens, like individual pieces, I can just check if the tokens match the various commands, like game mode and creative for example. Now I should be able to type game mode survivor or creative, and see the server updates me. But fun time is over. Let's start optimizing. So in order to optimize anything, you first need to measure. Guys, I can't stress this enough. I see so many beginners optimizing things that they don't even know if they run slow. Fortunately, I already have a profiler implemented. So I created a profiler for the server. Now I just add these lines here to profile various pieces of the server code. And here it is. It seems to be running pretty well actually. The budget for a server frame is 50 milliseconds, because we want to update the server 20 times a second. So let's start moving around, because generating chunks takes some extra time. And see, there is clearly an impact, but it is good overall. Oh, and if I increase the render distance, the server really starts to take a lot of time to run, even if I finish loading all the chunks. See, all the chunks have been loaded, and the server still takes quite some time to run each frame. And I also have to mention that the networking conditions are unrealistic. I'm basically sending packets to myself. So that's like the single player scenario. But if you play with friends, you will receive packets from a server somewhere else, and they will have a significant delay. So I can simulate real network conditions with this tool called Clumsy. And once I add things like delay and also packet loss, things seem okay at first, but if I worsen the network conditions just a little more, and I play around a little, either the client or the server times out the connection, and you get disconnected just like this. So I would like to fix that. So the first thing to do here is to find out if the client times out or the server. I'll just print that to the console, and I also have a feeling that I tried to send too many packets at once, getting a buildup of unsent data. So I'll just also get a measurement of that. Everything good so far? Let me now worsen the network conditions. Oh, take a look here. The chunk stopped updating. So that means that the server disconnected the player. And any time now, the client will also time out. Other times, however, the client will disconnect first. But fortunately, looking at all these metrics, and also having many prints in the code, I managed to figure out why that happens. But we need to dive into how the server works in order to understand that. So the server starts here, a dnet server function. First, it will load the world generator settings. Here, it will send time updates to the clients. It will receive pending messages, and then it will call into the next function called server worker update. And by messages, I mean whenever the client is trying to tell the server, like if it modified or if it used an item or placed a block. It's important to note, however, that I'm actually not doing anything with most messages yet. For some of them, I just instantly forward them to all the other clients, like player position updates to keep them as responsive as possible, and also chat messages. But all the other messages are just placed in a queue, and will be processed later for a very smart reason that I'll show later. So now, let's get into the server worker update. So remember when I said that the server runs 20 times per second? That means the entities and most of the world logic will be updated only a few times per second. There's no need to do it more often. So I have a timer to make sure I don't update it more often than needed. But then, I don't want to mess around doing nothing waiting for the timer to go down. There is still work that needs to be done. So I'm going to use this time to load and unload chunks, because that's probably the most expensive operation. And now here comes the part where the server feels more like an operating system. I refactored the server a bit, and now it is fully responsible for what chunks the player has. And this is very useful, because if I know what chunks are loaded by a player, I know to send entity updates for that chunk or not, without guessing around. But here is the catch. Generating chunks is expensive. Sending chunks is expensive. And all the players want a ton of chunks. So what can we do? Well, this is very similar to an operating system that needs to allocate time on the CPU for each program that you run on your machine. And all of them want to run on your CPU. So you need to somehow allow each program to use the CPU only for a specific amount of time. You also need to be careful, because the OS itself needs to run some time on that CPU. Otherwise, the computer will start to lag or even crash. Some kernels try to allocate the same time to each process. Others will try to give priority to some specific processes. And you also need to take into account that not all programs need the same amount of CPU time to run properly. But you can't make a perfect algorithm either, because you need to execute that algorithm and take time on the CPU yourself. So it's better to make a simple algorithm, but that leaves more time for the other programs to run on the CPU. So back to our server. Generating chunks takes a ton of time. So I will only generate one chunk per server frame to make sure the server also has time to execute. Just like how the OS doesn't want to be stalled by other programs. If the server doesn't update networking messages for too long, all the clients will time out. Okay, so this seems good so far, but we still have some problems. Let's say I only send one chunk per frame. That's great, but those chunks will accumulate very fast and queue up to be received by the client. If I place a block, the server will need to validate that placement, and that will be placed as the last event in the queue. And the block chunks and action-related things are all done in order to make sure they are correct. But now, the client will have to wait a ton of time to receive the block validation, because it first has to receive the chunk updates, and if I need to wait too long for a validation, I assume that somehow that packet was lost and the connection was compromised. So I need to disconnect the client, because it probably isn't in sync with the server anymore. But we don't want to get there, so we need to limit how many chunks are being sent to the player at one time. We need to somehow find how many chunks haven't been received by the player yet. I suspect that the library that I'm using somehow must know when the player receives a packet, because it needs that information to implement reliable messages. Yes, see, there is an internal mechanism for marking messages as received by players. I then emailed the creator of init to ask for some help, and I was lucky to get a very quick response. And so, I was able to limit the chunks being sent to only 5 at a time. So, this is with no limit. And yes, the chunks load blazingly fast, but you can also see there is quite a strain on the server. However, if I set the limit to 5, you can see there is a lot more breathing room for the server. There is still one more problem though. Remember that there are more players, so each time, I just go through all the players and load only one chunk. And the order will just stay the same every time. So you can quickly see that players that connect later will have a hard time getting chunks. So to easily solve this, I will do a simple trick here. I will just randomly shuffle the order in which I update the players each frame. I know this isn't the best solution, but it is actually a good strategy. All the players will be updated equally fast, and it is also extremely simple and fast. And if I want in the future, I could also prioritize players with very few chunks by reordering the vector again. But for now, the only special thing I do is that I always generate the chunk that the player is in, no matter what, to simplify my code later. And let me give you a quick tip. Whenever you add a rule like this one to your code, don't just write a comment and hope you don't forget about it. Enforce your rule by using an assert. Video in the description for more details. I usually make my own assert function, so it runs in both release and debug. And here I'm basically checking that the player's chunk are indeed always loaded. And I can of course remove this kind of check for the final builds. But until then, I'll have enough time to check that the system works as expected, because the assert will notify me every time I mess something up. And yes, that happened a ton of times. Okay, so let's wrap up the chunk logic. I'm planning to also make it multi-threaded, both on the client and the server, to make loading blazingly fast. And I know multi-threading might sound scary, but not if you do it like me. So the secret is to not have race conditions, as you'll see later in the video. You don't want multiple threads to access the same data. So on the server side, I will just launch and submit a task to generate a chunk, and the thread will write the answer somewhere. Then, once that chunk was generated, I will just take it. So I'm only communicating with the thread to request him chunks and to read back the result once it is fully ready. At no time do both threads access the same data. And I can even use multiple threads at a time to generate multiple chunks. But if this felt crazy, wait until you see the next part of the server. So after the server loads chunks, it also allows chunks that aren't needed anymore. And I also have a limit here. And this is what pro Minecraft players like to abuse. Since in Minecraft, there's also a limit of chunks to unload. they basically keep loaded some specific chunks that will be unloaded first, so that Minecraft can't ever unload other chunks. But I don't have problems like this, because lol, after a chunk is marked as to be unloaded, I just pretend it doesn't exist anymore, even though it hasn't been unloaded yet. Also, as soon as there are no players close to a chunk, I immediately mark it to be unloaded. And here I'm saving the chunks where players have built to the disk. And again, I have a per frame limit. But I'm constantly saving the world. Basically, instead of just doing it every few minutes, like in Minecraft, so that if you force close the game, you don't lose your progress, and also because lol, it's better to save changes as soon as you have them, rather than just watch them accumulate, and then start to save them all after a few minutes. Why not spread that work out as much as possible? Also, like, imagine having a ton of things to save,
and you close the server.
Now you need to wait for it to save all the data. Couldn't be me, lol. Okay, and now we get into this stick update. And remember, this is executed 20 times per second. And here the interesting things start to happen. So imagine there are some players around the world, and these are the chunks that they load. Let's call these chunks regions. And now you can see that they can't actually interact with one another in any way, right? So then, why not update each region in a different thread? I store entities inside the chunks that they are in. So then, just by giving the chunks to each region, I'm also giving it all the entities it needs to update. And now, check this out. Remember the messages that I received a long time ago in init server function? And that I've been carrying around with me this whole time? Well, guess what? Now I just have to look at what player is that message from, and forward it to the appropriate region. And it gets even better, because I can actually safely send packets from individual threads for each player without any mutex or synchronization. So I can basically fully execute and respond to the player's packets on multiple threads. And this is great, because if multiple people decide to venture out on their own, it wouldn't slow down the server almost at all, like it would do in Minecraft. So how crazy is that? Just by organizing my data nicely, I can easily implement multithreading. And that's why I recommend you to do data-oriented design instead of OOP. Instead of thinking of your code in terms of abstract objects, you should think of what problem you are trying to solve and what's the best way to organize your data to help you with that. But wait, I promise that this optimization gets even crazier. Many people ask me, how do I split the chunks into regions? And if merging them costs much? Well, I actually build the regions from scratch every frame. It actually isn't something expensive at all, because I just use pointers to chunks. So I just need to do a BFS to determine what the regions are, and then put the chunk pointer for each region into a data structure. And that's it. I can just send the data to the update. And at the end, I almost don't need to do anything, because all the changes have been written to the right chunks. The only thing I need to take care of is entities that moved into another chunk, and move them there. Now looking at the profiler, it seems like the random tick update takes a ton of time to process when there are a ton of chunks loaded. The random tick update is the thing that makes grass randomly grow, and I simply need to do it for many blocks. So even though it totally helps doing it on multiple threads if the players are in different areas, there are still a ton of chunks to update. I think this is why Minecraft has this simulation distance thing here. I mean, after all, it makes sense. The only way to optimize this is to reduce the number of chunks you update. Bro, no way Minecraft actually doesn't do any updates at all outside the simulation distance. This is huge, because if we look back at our regions thing, imagine two players have a very big render distance. In this case, I have to simulate this thing as one region. But once I introduce the simulation distance, even though these two players' view distances intersect, their simulation area doesn't intersect. So I can simulate them on two different threads. And get ready for the craziest part. If this won't convince you to use data-oriented design, I don't know what will. Instead of giving all these chunks to the tick update, I can simply only pass the chunks in the simulation distance to the tick update. So I don't have to loop through all the chunks that I don't care about. This isn't perfect though, because it means you only block changes for far chunks, but like you can't have both 100 chunks render distance, and also multiplayer with like other 10 people. You just need to cut some corners. It's crazy though that the GPU can render all these blocks with no problem, while the CPU struggles to check a fraction of these blocks for the random tick update. Anyway, after all these updates, the server does a very good job of staying in the 20 ticks per second range. And yes, the world gen is still a bit tight, but after I move that to some worker threads, we will truly be blazingly fast. This is 50 render distance, so that means a radius of 50 chunks. And now, I need to implement LODs for the chunks, and also loading the chunks on the client on multiple threads. And we'll get to probably double the render distance. And I also have to work on the weapons soon, so subscribe to not miss on the next video. You can also join my channel if you want to support me. And now, maybe check out the first part of optimizing the game. See you!